As we continue to move along with the proceedings today, I'm very much looking forward to this. Good morning, my name's Lachlan Kitchen here from Golf News. And as we just await the last couple of people coming in that are still getting their cups of tea and take their seats again, we move along to the next topic, which is future-proofing the health of nations through innovation and sustainable solutions. Now, the UAE has been at the forefront of the battle against the pandemic. I think we can all remember roughly this time last year, we had our 8 p.m. lockdown. We had drones going over the city doing sanitization. We had the claps around a lot of areas for the healthcare workers and the frontline workers at 8 p.m. But 12 months on, the good news is the economy is now opening up rapidly, but it's also doing it with confidence. The tectonic plates have seemed to shift, especially when it comes to healthcare. From a relative sick care system, policymakers and institutions have now committed to more preventative healthcare. From traditional systems of healthcare, solution-driven entities, and reimagining health to enhance human performance and protect life by effectively scaling AI offerings to fuel the next generation of innovation. From an approach of one size fits all, change makers are on a mission to future-proof the health of nations through innovation, through innovative, rather, bespoke solutions. So I'm really excited about the guests I can introduce to you this morning. Please welcome Dr. Fahed Al-Marzooqi, who is the Chief Operating Officer at G42 Healthcare, Hanif Khalak, the Chief Technology Officer at G42 Healthcare, and Dr. Asma Al-Mannaei, Director of Healthcare Quality, Department of Health, Abu Dhabi. You can give them a round of applause, please. Thank you very much. So we've got a series of questions which we'll work through. If I can start with you being closest to me, Dr. Fahed. How does a policymaker, you know, when it comes to making laws and policies, how do they embrace innovation with scaling from a regulatory perspective?
Thank you, Lachlan. Again, Your Excellencies and Ambassadors, thank you for being here with us. I'm sure Dr. Asma, being representing the regulator, she'll add more to what I have to say, but from our perspective, you know, the pandemic truly sideswiped everyone and affected everyone globally. And what we could see is really the growth and the impact in the economy goes hand in hand with the health of your public. So those past 18 months, we saw changes within regulators, within policies on a daily basis. We saw different partnerships happen between different enterprises, and people had to pivot and had to innovate and had to face this challenge as an opportunity. We've got industries that literally came to a standstill, and we've got industries, being us representing the healthcare, truly stood in front of the pandemic and looked it directly in the eye and had to provide the services to the people of the country. Now, if you look globally, certain health systems, unfortunately, had a tougher time than others. And when it comes to sustainability, that's the topic of this forum, you know, governments had to think, what is it that we're lacking, or what is it that we have to sustain the future of our country? And something that blew everyone's mind is something as simple as this, you know, a mask, or what we call it, personal protective equipment, that sometimes you brush off and you don't think about, and you walk by in supermarkets, became a staple, and that was in shortage globally, and everyone had to scramble and purchase and bring to their healthcare providers. Dr. Asma, anything to add on that?
Yeah, Dr. Asma, getting your thoughts on this, because you're working for the Department of Health Abu Dhabi. You know, when it comes to sort of these regulations, you know, how hard is it to sort of be progressive and understand that you've got to make these laws to protect people, like the mask wearing? You know, it's a tough challenge to get people to change their habits, isn't it?
Indeed. And just from a regulator point of view, and we need, first of all, to understand why. Why the regulator would shift from, you know, moving from the current status quo into something more innovative, new, fairly not very frequently known, and it's very important to understand the why. Why regulator needs to think and rethink on its perspective and the way to regulate healthcare. Actually, the reason is we want to provide the best of care for our patient. We want to give them the highest level of quality. But then you will reach the glass, let's say, ceiling. There will be a limit and a bar threshold that you cannot go and exceed, because this is how the textbook healthcare is giving us to treat our patient. In order to raise the bar, in order to challenge our status quo, we have to embrace innovation. And that would determine a different role for a regulation to act on. We have to be more of an open-minded. We have to be more an enabler regulator rather than a conservative regulator. So we need, first of all, of course, not to underestimate the number one priority for our population, which is safety, but we need to create the ecosystem that will enable the innovation to be fostered in a safe environment, provide access for our patient to try and test those innovation, because this is where the future is heading. This is the solution for our healthcare problems. This is where we are going to give a better healthcare, a cost-efficient approach, and a better access for our people. This is the why. When we understand the why, then we understand what is required for us as a regulator to do. And we have, within the Department of Health, realized that, alhamdulillah, very fortunately, even before COVID. So we have created a health tech hub, which is a sandbox environment in collaboration with Abu Dhabi Investment Office, Hub 71, Department of Economic Development. All those stakeholders came together to create this enabling ecosystem. Don't be afraid from the regulator in Abu Dhabi anymore. We are here to help you. And many of the successful startups have been incubated in Abu Dhabi, and now they have reached the commercialization and they are successfully rolling out their new innovative technologies that if you speak to perhaps maybe a doctor 2 or 3 years back, they might be saying, no, I did not read this in Cochrane Library, or I did not see this published in a journal and so on. It is now we have the true evidence based on data. It is working, and it is successful with an immediate commercialization opportunity. So this is an open invitation for all the innovators, SMEs, startups. Please join in our ecosystem in Abu Dhabi for healthcare, and we are here to help you. Thank you.
It's a good point, and I think that also requires real leadership, you know, to ask the why, you know, and be able to make those decisions. So I think that goes to show why the Department of Health in Abu Dhabi has been doing so well in fighting this pandemic. Moving over the end to Hanif, you know, from a regulatory perspective, looking at you, you know, how hard is it to kind of come up with these decisions, you know, to try and be at the forefront of change?
Yes, thank you, Lachlan. Assalamu alaikum. Really honored to be here. The sustainability in the context of, let's say, healthcare, and especially with regulation, I would say technology is, you know, usually the cutting edge. You know, you sort of break new ground, and I would say the way of making technology impact on society, and especially healthcare, sustainable is, I think, first and foremost, is security. Scalability means we can do it and, let's say, democratize, which means many people can benefit, so it's not expensive, but then also reliability. So I think the challenge in a regulatory environment is that, for example, PCR testing as a biotechnological fact, PCR testing should be accurate and shouldn't have too many false positives. So this sustainability of a test, when new variants come, when we go from 10,000 to 100,000 to a million a month, we shouldn't have to reinvent or should be reinvent quickly. So the sustainability is all about scale, security, and reliability. I hope that answers you.
Well, staying with you, you spoke about from a regulatory perspective, but when it comes to sustainable solutions, which we certainly need now, how does it really come from a tech? What would you say would be, you know, what kind of solutions are needed from a health technology perspective to be sustainable?
Absolutely. So I mean, when you talk about technology directions, sustainability is a bit different. It's not a conservative goal. It ends up being growth and being future-proof. So this idea of sustainability is for the future, but it's not a steady state. It's about growth. And the fourth industrial revolution is basically about big data, cloud, and AI. That is actually a Group 42 mission, is cloud, AI, and big data, especially when it comes to healthcare. When we say sustainability, it's about staying growth path to where the technology is not actually stagnant, but in fact we can continue to develop, and the startup ecosystem is really one that's required. It's not just a good idea, it's something we have to do.
And it's a challenge for every industry, obviously, how to be sustainable and how to use that. Dr. Asma, you know, speaking of those solutions and technology, do you think that artificial intelligence solutions hold a promise of predicting better, improving health and well-being?
Absolutely. As you know, in medicine and medical school, we are taught to practice evidence-based medicine, which is, you know, we need to have an evidence before we act and treat people. AI and information and data driven healthcare is the future of healthcare right now, because it's not necessarily that we need to wait perhaps maybe 5 or 10 years for evidence to be published and readily accessible for people. We can have that evidence in almost real time in order to have a better informed decision for the people and the patient health. AI will give us and is giving us a shortcut for new discoveries, and specifically in research and the application of the real world evidence. It is going to, and it is transforming how medicine is being practiced right now. The information, the data, whether it is the genomic data or the clinical information data, it gives us a real information on how this is going to be achieved. The machine learning, the artificial intelligence, the using of multiple algorithm and analysis in order to check on what would be the best scenario for precision medicine and personalized medicine. This is actually happening. We are not talking about the future. This is in reality, and we hope the UAE and Abu Dhabi will be among the first enabler and executor of an artificial intelligence healthcare-driven system. Thank you.
I think it is. For any medical students, it must be hard to realize that it's also going to change so fast in what you're practicing and what you're learning. And a couple of years ago, from personal experience, my father's Australian was in Sydney. He had a heart operation, and the doctor was in Singapore working on a Da Vinci machine. And you realize just that the future is now. You know, it's not something in the movies. We're working with it presently. Dr. Fahed, you're the COO of G42 Healthcare. On that same topic, artificial intelligence, you know, how is this going to predict a better health and well-being for the people?
Yes, Lachlan. Again, I want to tag on what Dr. Asma and Mr. Hanif mentioned. The first thing that I want to tag on is an important word that Dr. Asma mentioned, and that is enablers. So as the regulators in the Emirate of Abu Dhabi and Dubai Health Authority and the Ministry of Health, the notion of working in silos disappeared. The regulators actually brought us with them on the table, whether it is the public health system or the private sector. We were sitting with them on the table, making decisions alongside each other and putting the plan moving forward. So when it comes to the next phase of medicine, again, as you mentioned, when you mentioned medical students, you know, we entered the phase of reactive medicine, and some countries are aspiring for preventative medicine. But how can we go to the next phase of predictive and personalized medicine? And that is where we are right now, and this is what the regulators are supporting us to enable, working with them together and partnering in this endeavor.
Understanding the patient, it's the key, isn't it, always? You know, sometimes it's better to understand the patient than it is the disease, you know, is the old saying.
And it's not just the patient. You need an organization, an ecosystem that's willing to reinvent the wheel and pivot. You know, as human beings, we're always comfortable in a specific zone. We study test books in medicine, and that's what they say how you manage a disease. But going to the next phase, that is where the challenge is. And if you don't have the ecosystem to support that, you're not going to succeed.
So how do you get the ecosystem to support that? What are the challenges that you need to do in order to make sure that people are willing to evolve and are willing to get out of that comfort zone?
It's multifactorial. So there is regulators, there is the scientists and the inventors, you get universities and research. So you need that complete ecosystem to be able to achieve that. Otherwise, if there is any missing factor in between, you won't be able to do it alone.
Well, I guess when keeping that ecosystem is all about quite often partnerships, it's quite often about collaboration. And when you're looking for investing in healthcare, how important is it, and what are some of those challenges in having partnerships and collaborations?
Again, that's the key word. And we have a saying in Arabic, one hand can't clap alone. Yeah. So you need to partner with not just the public sector and the regulators, even the private sector, because each one can bring their own expertise to the table. And when I say partnering, again, it doesn't mean focus on the local partners or regional. Again, we have members here from different parts of the world. Each domain has their own level of expertise. UAE is a young country, yet it's full of passion and fire to move forward. Some of the countries here are ages older us with experience. So bringing those establishments that have that experience and the know-how and working together will eventually benefit humanity.
It's a good point. When you are a young country, you're not sort of, as we would say, stuck in sort of a lot of routines. You often have a lot of energy to be able to change things. And I think the UAE has been so good in the past 12 months in perhaps taking a few risks, you know, and being at the forefront of those advancements. Dr. Asma, your experience investing in healthcare, you know, you're working for the Department of Health Abu Dhabi. How important are partnerships and collaborations to achieve your goals?
Actually, it's very, very important. We know that in order to create a proper ecosystem, it is not about having this organization doing this kind of a job or this initiative or this project. Actually, the most important thing is about the interaction between those two organizations, about the collaboration, about the actual connectivity between the dots. It's not about the dot itself. So definitely, this cannot happen by a single organization. It is a journey. And it is an ecosystem. Each will have a specific role. For example, we are the regulator. We cannot be an investor. But we can enable and support the investor and the entrepreneurship and the startup within their system by creating the appropriate regulation for their new technology, for example. So we will not be able to create this new regulation unless we work directly and we know this technology, what is required. We work with the different partners to see how this is contributing to the bigger picture of prosperity of our population. So interactions and communication is the most valuable part to create a sustainable, future-proof system.
I couldn't agree more. And Hanif, your role, Chief Technology Officer, clearly, you know, when you're working with so many outside parties as you would often in technology, you know, what are some of the important factors when it comes to partnerships and collaborations in trying to evolve the technology?
Absolutely. There's really technology nowadays. There's a shortage of chips, for example, on the market. It's just the fact that just to get and access to things, we have a very strategic relationship with NVIDIA. It's one of the largest computing companies in the world, and G42 established one of the top 20 supercomputers. We couldn't have done it without not just NVIDIA, but the cloud, our cloud partners, the healthcare. Healthcare is actually one of the largest users of the supercomputing resource, but we're not a supercomputing team. We need the supercomputing team, the cloud team, our vendors. Literally no one can be out of the room. Everybody has to be in the room. And now we're working on, for example, our next generation. We're going to 1 million genomes. Even the supercomputer we had is not enough. We have to, how you say it, soup it up. But it's not just hardware, software. And as we know, software is redefining everything, and no one person or no one team or no one company partner actually knows how to do it alone. I talked to NVIDIA, our CEO met with Jensen Wang, And they're like, but we need to work together. And it's not about a sales cycle. Literally, money doesn't solve the problem. We actually just, we need to do it together. They can't do it alone. Of course, they would love to do it with us. They're doing it with Genome England. But Emirati project is actually even more ambitious than the project in UK, to where we will be establishing a capability, and we cannot do it without NVIDIA, and they have an interest in doing with us at a global level. And of course, the DNA sequencing, the cloud technologies are all cutting edge, and we couldn't do it without them.
Look, we could speak all day about this, but we've got a lot of great speakers we'd like to get through. So I'll pose one question to you each just before we wrap up today's session. And Hanif, you know, I'll start with you. Can you give me, please, your top three recommendations, or maybe your thoughts, on what the key players, the key influencers, should be building on to help create sustainable healthcare solutions?
The three top enabling technologies, we'll say. There's no question, probably one of the main ones is going to be artificial intelligence applied at all levels. So right now, there's a skill gap in terms of finding people who both know computer science, artificial intelligence, and healthcare. The entire, we'll call it the healthcare stack, you know, from the laboratory and the clinic all the way up to the public health and regulatory sort of policy setting. AI could have an incredible impact. In fact, the estimate is just within UAE, the government level, AI could have a 50% efficiency impact, and all across the spectrum. Healthcare in particular is not known as an efficient, you know, a way of delivering services, but we don't know any other way. So human beings, we can try hard. So AI is something really gonna have a huge impact. And when you say AI, many people still have to catch up to what would it mean to use it. So I think this is an enabling area. Another is cloud technologies. And what do I mean by cloud? You know, it's not up in the sky, right? There's a data center somewhere, but it has to be in country, but all the players in the country as partners can team up and use a common infrastructure so that we don't have to move huge amounts of data and people from place to place. We can operate within a UAE cloud, and in fact, I think G42 has built a government cloud where we'd like to have other partners partnering, as we said. So cloud technologies, to where we don't, each person doesn't have their own data, we can, especially for COVID, one of the saving graces of COVID showed the value of putting data together. We're able to get to contact tracing and policy faster. And I think the third is security. So we can do AI, but if we do, there's a famous example of Microsoft released an open source chatbot, and the chatbot started learning racist comments.
And it's also having, you know, patients having the faith that their, you know, their details aren't going to be violated as well. It's always a huge concern. So I'll take those three. Moving along, Dr. Asma, do you have the same three or any other ones you'd like to share or add or change?
Well, I'd like to take this a bit differently and to consider call for action or three recommendations that I would like to perhaps maybe call for our fellow friends within the healthcare system. Three recommendations. One is for regulator and policymaker. The first recommendation is to rethink how we are regulating healthcare system right now. Rethink, and perhaps maybe it is time to position the regulator as an enabling regulator for new innovations in healthcare. The second is for the provider, for the hospitals, for the frontliner who are providing the healthcare system. The recommendation would be is to adopt those new innovation. Use them for the benefit of your patient. Don't be afraid of those new gadget that you see. Actually, it is working and it will benefit your patient, it will save your time. Last but not least, which is to reiterate the key message for our innovators, for the entrepreneurship, for the SME and startups, this is where the future is. And please come forward. Come forward for the regulator, come forward for the frontliners, and come forward. We need to see you, we need to hear you, and we need to support you. And that's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Asma. Dr. Fahed, we've had six good examples. Have you got your top three recommendations?
I will take it in a different way. I'm looking at it from you need passion, you need agility, and definitely in those times, a sense of time. You know, speed is of the essence, time is of the essence. You know, the pandemic is swiping by, and you need to pivot accordingly.
Thank you very much. I think we can all agree that how important it is to be sustainable by having, you know, enablers and having a great team and having points of view to be able to work together. And I find that so interesting to ask the same question and get such different answers, I think is one of the joys of sharing wealth, the wealth of knowledge that today is all about. If I can thank again our panelists, Dr. Fahed Al Marzooqi, Chief Operating Officer at G42 Healthcare, Hanif Khalak, Chief Technology Officer at G42 Healthcare, and Dr. Asma Al Mannaei, Director of Healthcare Quality Department of Health Abu Dhabi. A round of applause for our distinguished guests. Thank you very much. Thank you to the three of you. You're fantastic. In a moment, we'll move on to our next topic. Noni will be back in just a couple of minutes to discuss the UAE circular economy. Thank you.